Perhaps more shocking than the rules that were broken by Owen Paterson were the rules that weren't. Paterson, you'll remember, broke lobbying rules because he arranged governmental meetings for people who paid him. But my initial reaction to this story was, why was he getting paid by external private companies in the first place? Like all MPs, Owen Paterson already had a well-paid job. MPs make £82,000 a year. That puts them in the UK's top 5% of earners. Being an MP should also keep anyone fairly busy. Diligent MPs report working upwards of 60 hours a week, contributing to debates, drafting written questions, and representing constituents. So why did anyone think it was acceptable for someone such as Owen Paterson to have two external jobs, which gave him obligations to provide time to these private corporations instead of his constituents, and which paid him an extra £112,000 per year, dwarfing the already handsome sum he got for his, well, what's supposed to be at least, his main job. Of course, on this front, Owen Paterson was not alone. To get an idea of some other MPs who couldn't bear to live on £80,000 a year, these are some of Paterson's standout peers. Andrew Mitchell is a former chief whip, now a backbench Tory MP. In 2020, on top of Mitchell's MP salary, he earned an extra £240,000. This included £30,000 for 5 days work with the accountancy firm Ernst & Young and £50,000 plus shares and options for 8 days at Equinox International Holdings Limited, a private equity and venture capital firm. One wonders if those 8 days' work can really justify £50,000, or if the private equity firm sees other benefits to having an MP on their payroll. Next up is Fiona Bruce, another Conservative. She earns £180,000 on top of her MP salary. Bruce practices law through her own firm. In 2020, six separate consulting jobs earned her the equivalent of up to £11,487 per hour. We can also show you Richard Fuller. He earned £175,000 in 2020. That was for committing 2 hours per month to a number of directorships and chairmanships, including a brand protection firm, a software company, and a venture capital firm. This is a man with his fingers in many lucrative pies. Finally, we've got Sajid Javid, someone I'm sure you will recognise, before being appointed Health Secretary this year. But after holding the position of Chancellor, Javid bagged a job with JP Morgan, which paid him £150,000 a year. To receive that sum, Javid worked 6 to 8 hours per month, meaning the role paid at least £1,875 per hour. We should note that, unlike Owen Paterson, none of the MPs mentioned here have been found to have broken any lobbying rules. But you've got to wonder why these firms would pay MPs so much money for working just a few hours a month. Either these are exceptionally productive people, some of the most productive people in the world, worth £1,800 a month, or they aren't just being employed for their labour power. Ash, why does anyone think this is acceptable? Why is this normal that we have MPs whose side jobs pay them more than their main job?
Because the people who would be trusted to fix this are the ones who benefit financially from this arrangement. I think that an awful lot of MPs don't see a conflict between representing their constituents, being entrusted with our democracy, and being paid to effectively be the voice of capital or particular corporations while they are in parliament. And that's something which is really, really wrong. The simplest way to get rid of this would be to impose just a blanket ban on MPs having second jobs while they are, in fact, MPs. You could obviously make certain exemptions, for example, if you are an MP and a local councillor at the same time, or something like that. There are ways to do this where it's reasonable. But it's perfectly obvious to me that if what you're doing is 6 to 8 hours work a month and you're being paid £150,000, what you're being remunerated for is not the actual work you're doing. It's being an MP with, prospects who can, one day get back a cabinet post. And that's worth investing in. If you're an organization like JP Morgan or, Ernst & Young or a venture capital firm or whoever else, you're paying for influence, even if you're more subtle and less egregious a rule breaker than Owen Paterson. You are still effectively a shill for a corporation while you should be doing your job representing your constituents.
What justifies it? So some people say, oh, £80,000 isn't enough. As I've said, that does put you in the top 5% of earners in Britain. So if you don't think that's enough, you should probably, you know, you're the lawmakers. Maybe you could increase people's wages if you don't think £80,000 is enough to live on. You could increase everyone else's wages, I mean. Some people think £80,000 isn't enough, though. Tory MP Peter Bottomley wrote an article on Thursday headlined, "To Prevent Another Scandal, Pay MPs More." This follows a recent interview in the Evening Standard where the same theme was raised. In that piece, we discovered that Sir Peter, who has been in the Commons since 1975 and is its longest serving MP, said he is currently not struggling financially, but he believes the situation is desperate for newer colleagues. He added, "I don't know how they manage. It's really grim." Remember, as I keep saying, the incomes he has described are in the top 5% of British salaries. If you think that is grim, then can you please change some laws? Because how do you think it is like to live on, you know, 20 grand, or the median wage was about 27. No, this doesn't stand up. That was Bottomley's argument for higher pay. Yet even if MPs did get that pay rise, he still doesn't think that should preclude them taking other well-paid jobs. This isn't one of those arguments where people say we should ban second jobs, but that means we'll have to raise their salary. No, he wants both second jobs and get paid more. So this was his argument for why they should be allowed to have second jobs. This was in the Times article, the headline of which I just showed you. So he writes, "To those who say no outside earnings, I ask whether Michael Foot should have refused his book royalties or put down his pen while he was an MP. Peter Furnham was a redundant engineer. He used his payoff to buy machine tools and created a thriving metal-forming business. It would have been over the top to disqualify him from the Commons unless he sold up." So those are the two examples of MPs having second jobs or second sources of income that Peter Bottomley thinks are most persuasive as to why they shouldn't be banned. Personally, I think Michael Foot could have donated those royalties to charity. And sorry, Peter, it doesn't seem to me that one successful steel firm is good enough reason to risk the corruption of our entire parliamentary system.
Look, it's a really cynical pair of examples to use, which is somebody on the left who's written a book and, you know, somebody who has got proximity to manual labour. That's plainly not what we're seeing with, you know, the 72 landlords who voted against a law which would have made homes fit for human habitation. That's not what we're seeing with Sajid Javid earning hundreds of thousands of pounds from a giant global bank. That's certainly not what we were seeing with Owen Paterson either. But again, if you wanted to, you know, just have a blunt instrument of a law and wipe out second jobs entirely, do it. Do it. The loss that I think that you would get from people who maybe have sources of income which aren't so egregiously exploitative or corrosive to our democracy, for instance, Rosina Allen Khan, who is still a practicing doctor, I think is more than made up for by what you gain in MPs who aren't either formally or informally being paid to be lobbyists for a private corporation.
There's all these good deeds that MPs could do. We wouldn't want to stop them doing that and going out in society and, you know, helping people in a hospital or whatever. Well, if that's their real motivation, if their real motivation is to contribute to society, maybe any income could go to some members of parliament charitable trust, which goes to some, you know, charity that everyone agrees is a good thing. Birds, maybe RSPB or something that everyone on all sides of the house can agree is fine. It goes to that. Or the National Lottery, something like that.
Not even the NSPCC, Michael. You were like, you know what? I think parliamentarians, they're a bit split on abused children. But I mean,
the past decade would show that there are many Tory MPs who are happy to punish kids. So
I mean, that is true. But
I haven't seen them punish birds. So I would place money on the RSPB being the one that gets the least complaint.
I don't know. You say you've not seen them punish birds, but Richard Drax, who was one of the Tory MPs who was being investigated by the Standards Committee and voted to scrap it, he had failed to declare his, I think, 150-acre or something grouse moorland. Mm. So he basically maintains a spread of land in Yorkshire, which is used solely for hunting really stupid and defenseless birds. So I don't know.